kaya chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri guruve namaha shri chaitanya manobhishtam sthapitam yena bhutale swayam rupa kadamayam dadati swapadantikam vandeham shri guru shri yuta padakamalam shri gurun vaishnavamscha shri rupam sagrajatam sahagana raghunatam vitam tam sajivam sadvaitam savadutam parijana sahitam krishna chaitanya devam shri radha krishna padam sahagana lalita shri vishakhanvitamscha he krishna karuna sindho dina bandho jagatpate gopesha gopika kanta radha kanta namostute tapta kanchana gaurangi radhe vrindavaneshwari vrishabhanu sute devi pranamami hari priye jai shri krishna chaitanya prabho nityananda shri advaita gadadhar Shrivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Oh my God, it was a beautiful presentation. I would request all of you to come a little closer so that we can... I chose this topic, Oh my God, because I think it's the most common term which many of us use I think in a day, how many times, right? Oh my gosh, oh my gosh. Or in more popular SMS or Facebook language, OMG. So this is like, this term is quite popular now, right? It's a very popular term with the youth, and I did some Googling and I found out that there are so many. In fact, did you know that there is one subatomic ultra high energy particle which was first seen in the US state of Utah? This was seen. Hindi translation is happening behind. So near Prabhupada deity. So whoever would like a Hindi translation can sit behind. So this subatomic high energy particle was seen in the state of Utah in US, and because it was such a unique scientific phenomenon, and they didn't know what name to keep. Guess what name they kept? Oh my God particle. And then I found out that there's not just this. There is a video game called as Oh My God. There's a rock group, and there is a very famous song, and of course the famous movie, the most controversial movie of all, which is named after this Oh My God. And it's good that it's controversial, right? Because usually nobody, movies are, which kind of movies become controversial or famous? Definitely nothing related to God, right? Is anything other than God becomes very famous, very popular, and very, you know, much discussed and most viewed. So luckily, first time there's a, this became quite controversial, and this, so it's a good thing. But, you know, there are some really traditional Christians who feel that we should not use this term. oh my God, what's happening? Oh my God, you know, they feel, it's something like taking God's name without having any respect for God. And, you know, they really feel that it's like taking God's name in vain. In Bible, there is a very popular saying. I mean, there is one of the commandments actually. It's one of the commandments that thou shalt not take the name of God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless, whoever takes his name in vain. So like you can't just use frivolously. That's what some strong-minded Christians, they feel. That, oh my God, you should not just use this term very freely because you're calling out to the name of God. Because, and that's quite a point about it, because people make a ritual about it, right? For everything you just call out, you know, call out in vain. Like there was this very funny, you know, cartoon about a Brahmana who was meditating, and I mean, he was really calling out, "Hey Ma, mujhe darshan do. Hey Ma, mujhe darshan do. Hey Ma, mujhe darshan do." But in his mind, you know what was going on. Hey Ma, Hey Ma, Hey Ma, Hey Ma. Like, so, so we don't know. Like sometimes we are remembering God, but what's happening in the mind is something else altogether. So it is a phrase which is, you know, now this controversial movie, it has a very interesting theme, and I mean the story goes, of course you all must be knowing, that this guy, he doesn't believe in God at all, and he feels that this is just a business making, you know, going to temples or doing all these pujas is just to get people who are fearful of something happening to them. They do all these things, and then he goes about suing God. You know, actually, he has the, you know, he shows the courage to bring God to court. And his idea is like, who represents God? All these people who sell God, basically, who are marketing God. You know, I want to sue them to compensate for his loss. You know, whatever money, he wanted money out of them. And that's amazing how he logically, he wants to prove, he proves to them that, you know, that just ritualistic worship of God is not very. And the funny part is God himself comes and kind of sides him and supports him. So that's an interesting concept, but there was a many questions which came out of this. It kind of put a question in people's mind. That means what? You know, should we reject everything that is, you know, related to God, or, you know, so, and it's a good question. There were many good questions raised, and we want to, definitely, we are also going to address this point about, you know, there are so much malpractice or con, as there are con men. There are con men everywhere, if you go to see, isn't it? So, conning, like, you know, is conning means you fool people. Right? There are people who con people out of their money. Right? They are like chota mota thieves, you know, pocket mar, like. They just fool, cheat people and flick some purses, and, you know, and there are some little bigger con people who are like nicely, they wear suit, boot, and they are like very smart people, but they con people out of their properties or, you know, something more bigger. And of course, politicians, what to speak of politicians. They are like the biggest con men. And there are much, and there are those worst kind of cheaters or con men who actually exploit women. Right? You have seen, we have heard the recent horrible, violent case, how a woman was exploited. So this is a very, so it's like a real violent, this which we have all gone through, and we have been reading about it. And there are some who exploit people of their name and fame. But the worst kind of exploitation, the worst kind of con men are those people who are the so-called God men, as they say. This is a very famous term, God men. Or why are they the most deadliest? Why do I feel they are the deadliest? And the most, you know, because they are conning people, because they are showing people that we are the ones who can give you direct access to God, or we are the ones who can solve all your problems, just surrender to us, or kind of, you know, give us this or that, as we saw in the drama. But it's not that they are so dangerous because they are taking things from people. They are more dangerous because they are taking the faith of people. You understand? Is people who could actually direct their love, their faith towards God, who is the worthy person whom we should direct our love and faith and worship. These people, conning the people and taking all that faith and worship and love for themselves. And they are misleading the people. Instead of directing them to the path of God, they are misleading them, you know, towards just for some material gain. That's why they are the worst kind of con men. They con the people, they fool the people and take away their faith. And that is very painful. And I'm not talking, as we saw, there were few examples. I'm not talking about the genuine spiritualists, the genuine people, the devotees who have dedicated their lives to God. I'm not talking them because, about them at all, because they are a different league altogether. And we have seen, personally, I have seen such people. And such people are far from the limelight. They are in some village. They are serving the Lord with full devotion. They are not after name, fame or followers. They are the genuine spiritualists whose only aim is to love God and teach everyone how to love God. And there are such people, believe me. I have seen them. I have met them. And so that's the sad part, you know. When a politician dies, there is such a big fanfare, and then for months together there are photographs everywhere. They are like glorified. And when an actor dies, there is, you know, people following, crying, sleeping. You know, there's such a big fanfare or a show about when they leave their body. But a real spiritualist, when he passes away or when he leaves his body, he doesn't want to do it, you know, to publicize or make a big this about it. And there are thousands of such pure devotees or the pure spiritualists who are connected with the Lord, who are, you know, leaving in an unknown way, not known to the world. They are not famous. They are not popular. For example, like Srila Prabhupada, he started a worldwide organization. He traveled the globe 14 times. He spread the whole International Society for Krishna Consciousness all over the world. You know, till today, it's growing every day. But when he left his body, he went to a small village in Vrindavan. And he was surrounded only by his followers who were constantly chanting. And the news also, it was not such a big front page news. It was just one news in the corner. Why? Because that's not the aim of their lives. The aim of their life is not to get a following or to make people think, you know, that they are great saviors of the whole world. Even if they are, you know, their aim is not that. So that's, we understand, you know, that what is a real spiritualist? What is the quality of a real spiritualist? So we should be very careful. You know, definitely this movie has, you know, raised a lot of questions. At least it has made people think. Don't you think? What is your opinion? I feel that it was a good thing. At least the youth will start thinking about these matters. And if they are sincere in their hearts, God will direct them to the right place. It's just like buying gold. And if you want to buy gold, you should know exactly how gold looks like, right? You can't just, otherwise there are thousands of imitation shops. You go to Kolaba Causeway. There are lots of shops where you can get nice jewelry with a, you know, which is not gold. But if you want gold, you have to go to the right place and there will not be a crowd there. Not so much crowd. Because very few people want the genuine thing. But to get the imitation, there will be a big crowd. That's why the majority of people you see are those kind of people who are after these rituals, who are running after these godmen, Babas, Maulvis, and, you know, Baba Bengali and all these different kind of stuff to get their problems solved, you know. They want a quick fix. Everyone wants a quick fix, right? It's like cheating, you know. Is there a quick fix for anything in this world? There is no quick fix. Everything comes the hard way. But when you want a quick fix, means you want to cheat. And this whole world is a world of cheaters and the cheated. That's what Prabhupada used to say. The whole world is filled with the cheaters and the cheated. Now let me explain. He explains with a very interesting story. In the olden days, you know, the village men, you know, village families used to think that if we get our daughters married off to some sadhu or a very nice, you know, spiritual Baba, you know, Brahmachari, then, you know, he has no bad habits, he won't smoke, he won't drink, he won't eat, he won't beat my daughter. So let me just get my daughter married off to this nice Brahmachari. So they would go to this bank of the rivers where all these Babajis would sit and send their daughters with flowers and fruits, you know, to do seva. Babaji, liji, and you know, all that. So they would think that, okay, these people will fall for their daughters and get married and then get nice kids, you know. That was their thinking, you know. But people know, you know, if it's such kind of thoughts are there, then they are one ahead of them, you know. So all this chore and this, chore or uchakke, they would dress up like sadhus and sit near the bank of the river and, you know, like waiting, who will come? Which beautiful girl will come with flowers and fruits? And because their mentality was to cheat, so there are cheaters ready, you know, and they will become the cheated. So this whole world is full of cheaters and the cheated. So this is what happens. The point I'm trying to make is that there are thousands of people in this world who want quick fix, quick things, quick money, quick good husband, quick everything fast, fast, fast. Everything should happen, and they feel that just by paying some ritual, some brahmana for this ritual or doing some this vrat and paying this money, so much money for, you know, they think that all these things can be done. I mean, you can't blame them, you know. Everybody has problems and they want solutions, and unfortunately there are people who are ready to exploit them also, you know, in the name of God, in the name of religion, you know, all these rituals becomes like, you know, something out of fear also. People think, you know, if I don't do this, then something bad is going to happen to me. That's what is ritual, right? Rituals in religion is very, very common, and every religion has rituals. It's not just that Hindu culture has all these pujas and stuff. If you go to see, the Jewish tradition also has so many rituals. Even the Christians, they have the baptism and they have certain things which they have to do. Everything is a ritual. And the young people, they hate rituals. You know, they don't want anything which is rituals, right? Rituals in religion, the youth feel, why should we get into all this? It's so... But then I was wondering, you know, actually even the young people, they follow so many rituals. All of you. First thing you wake up in the morning is you charge your mobile, right? That's become a ritual today. Huh? Charging the mobile has become a ritual, or checking your WhatsApp every 5 minutes. Who in this room doesn't touch his mobile to check the WhatsApp or SMS once in 5 minutes? Put your hands up. Doesn't hai nahi hoga, mobile hi nahi hai. You touch or you don't touch every 5 minutes? Don't touch 5 minutes. Okay, good. She knows the dangers of mobiles. So everything has become a ritual. Watching IPL on TV, it's like a ritual. I'm talking about the general youth. So there are many things that are done as a ritual today. Watching TV, SMSing. And going against the parents on everything, that is also a ritual, which everybody wants to follow very diligently.
That has always been there.
Yeah, that has always been there. Don't trust anybody over 30. That's the motto of the young people, right? That was the motto in 1960s or 50s, before 1960s. So I am sure that same thing is going on. So there's nothing new basically. This is a ritual which all young people follow. So basically you do follow rituals. I mean to say that. So the point I'm making is that rituals are there in all religions and everybody follows rituals. In fact, Karl Marx, he's a very famous German philosopher, he said, you know, a very famous statement that religion is the opiate of the masses. You know, what's an opiate? Nasha. So, it's like a nasha, means people are so hooked on to the ritualistic way of worshipping God. Ritualistic way of worshipping God means thinking that just by doing some puja or some this, I am doing my job of being religious. But is that true? Is that enough? Is worshipping God a part-time job, just like, you know, you finish in some limited period of time? Basically, ritual, the word ritual means that you connect your consciousness to God. It's a formula. Ritual is a formula which all religions have, their own formulas. It's a formula by which you are connecting your consciousness to God. But today, what is happening is those rituals have just become like a, you know, a nasha, or doing it just to get some gains, to get some, fulfill some material desires, to fulfill some fears. Basically, it's a fear, you know, like the famous statement, they are all God-fearing people. They are not God-loving people. And the traditions that, you know, has set from so many years, the point is like, people do the rituals without understanding the reason behind it. And of course the youth don't like to accept anything without any explanation. There's a very funny story which Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj has said, how rituals start, you know, and it's really hilarious that there was a marriage ceremony going on and suddenly a cat got loose. And the cat was running here and there. So because it was disturbing the marriage, the mother of the bride just took a basket and put it over the cat. And the cat was under the basket, and the bride, the daughter saw this and she thought maybe that is a very important part of the, you know, procedure, that when this mantra goes on, there should be a cat and you should put a basket over it. So she did that when her daughter got married. She suddenly got a cat and she put a basket over it, and you know, then it happened for generations. It followed like this. Till some young modern person must have asked, why are you putting this basket over the cat? It's ridiculous. Why are you doing it? No, no, my mother also did it. Then her mother also did it. And you know, go back and then you realize that it has no meaning, no sense. That is what a ritual is. You know, you do without any understanding of the meaning. It's like blindly following rituals. This god, that god, Monday ko, you know, I don't know. You can tell Monday ko Ganpati, Tuesday ko Shankar. So every day there is one different god, and you have different rituals for it. And all of them are given in the Vedas. They have been given. There are very bona fide ways of serving all these. But a funny thing, there's a joke. One man who was a very diligent, ritualistic worshipper of God, every day he would do something, you know, every day he had his worship, this, and one day he was going in a boat and suddenly the boat was, you know, collapsed and he was about to drown, and he remembered all the mantras and he was trying to call out to Lord Shiva, Ganesh, Durga, you know, all the mantras he was chanting, and you know, he said, please save me, and he was chanting all the mantras and he drowned. And he went up to the heaven and he was so fuming, you know, saying, I was desperately calling, for years I was worshipping all of you and none of you came to save me. why didn't you come to save me? And then all of them said, Are, we thought that he will go. We thought that she will go. They all thought that someone will go and save him, but I don't have to go, you know. So, I mean, the moral of the story is that if you do all the rituals without understanding why you are worshipping, then I don't think you'll get any much benefit out of it. You know, but the point is the fear of God is put on, you know, if you don't do it, something really bad is going to happen. Do you know, 5,000 years back, something like this happened, where a young kid was, you know, when the young kid asked, why are we doing this puja? Why should we do this puja? And the father said, no, don't even ask this. If you ask, something very bad will happen. Don't even question. Do you know, when did this happen? Right, 5,000 years back, Lord Krishna, he is a representative of all youth, you know. He is the eternal youth. He asked his father, how, you know, why should we do this puja for Indra? So much tayari, you know, how much you are spending, how much you are arranging, so many, you know, foodstuffs and so many offerings. Why are you making all this for Lord Indra? Saying, how dare you ask such question? Don't even question. Lord Indra will stop rain if you even question like this. He said, but you explain to me logically. Why are we giving all this to Indra? We have not even seen him. Whether he is really coming and putting rain on, you know, sending rain. I have not seen Lord Indra coming and putting, sending rain. I can see that Govardhan with all his beautiful trees and, you know, all this greenery, it is facilitating, you know, so much. It's helping the environment and it is arranging, you know, the rains to fall, and it's serving the animals by providing such green grass. We should do the puja and offer everything to Govardhan. And he met with lot of opposition, but he convinced, of course, because he is God himself. So he convinced his father that why we should not do this ritual, and you know the whole story what happened. So that fear is put in us also, like if you question, in my case that's what happened. I was born in a typical ritualistic Brahmana family, where, like as we said, like it was said in the movie, there was a supermarket in the house. Supermarket of gods. There was a supermarket, you know, whatever you can choose, and we had so many rituals. And I was very, very frustrated and disappointed, and you know, because I used to find it like, what is the purpose of doing it? I couldn't understand the purpose at that time. So I would question, why is this happening? Why you're doing this puja? And there was nobody to answer my questions. The main reason why young people are away from all these things, or want to go away, or find this totally unfashionable or unscientific, is because there is no one to explain that why we have to, why are we doing this? If you go to see, just by doing the pujas and rituals, that is not real religiosity, or that is not real spirituality. It is just kind of a pseudo religiosity to make you feel, each one feels, I am doing my part. I am a very God fearing person. Huh? I felt that it was being done just to feel safe, like as if you are paying your premiums for protection, you know, for your insurance company. That was the example that was given. That I am giving my premium, so I will be protected in this sphere of my life. If I give this premium to this demigod, then I will be taken care of in this. And that is what the Vedas say. That is how it is explained. But the point is that it is cannot be part-time. You know, it is not pleasing to the Lord. As we see in the drama, and we also see in so many stories which we have read in Bhagavatam, God is giving so many examples how that you cannot please God just by doing some mechanical ritualistic thing. You cannot please God that way. And ultimate aim of religion is what? What is the goal of spirituality or religion? Every aim of every religion in this world is what? to love God and to please God, right? But what is the point if people engage in all these elaborate rituals, but the main aim of pleasing God, like it's like the main crux of what is real spirituality or real religion. If you don't do that, then what is the point? There's one more story in Bhagavatam which Lord Krishna himself, you know, he explains through his own pastimes. How you cannot please Krishna just by being ritualistic. You may be a great pandit, you may be knowing, you know, shlokas of Bhagavad Gita by heart and backwards also. But if you are doing it just as a ritual without understanding the meaning, then it is not pleasing God. So there's a very sweet pastime. One day Krishna and his friends went in the forest and they all felt hungry. After playing so much and they felt hungry. And they saw that there were some brahmanas who were doing yajnas and they were very, very knowledgeable and they were chanting mantras. And Krishna sent his friends, said, go and just beg them for some food, prasad. So his friends went and they asked the brahmanas, can you give us some food? We are very hungry. And they were so busy chanting their mantras that they couldn't even take a break to answer them. And they kept asking them, please, can you give us some food? And after a lot of irritation, all the brahmanas, they just screamed at the children. There's nothing here, don't waste our time. We are busy chanting mantras. We are doing this yajna to please Vishnu. So please don't waste our time. Get out from here. So they went back to Krishna very sad and Krishna and Balram pacified them. It's okay. When you go begging, some people give you something to eat. Sometimes they kick you away, you know. So you have to accept these things. And then Krishna and Balram went to the homes of these brahmanas. And there, the very, very simple housewives, you know, who didn't know any shastra, they didn't know any shlokas, they didn't know any ritual, they were simply cooking. They were just making the bhoga for their yajnas and they were preparing everything, making all the preparations. And Krishna and Balram went and asked them, can you please give us some food? And immediately, without thinking twice, without thinking that their husbands will get angry if you give all the offerings away, you distribute it to people. they just distributed all the foodstuffs to all of Krishna's friends. And Krishna and Balram, they were so pleased, they were so happy that they told them that, you know, you ask for any wish and it will be granted, you know. So they pleased Krishna so much just without knowing any rituals, without knowing any, having no knowledge. So the point here Krishna wanted to show to the world that with all the big rituals and knowledge, you know, external knowledge, if you cannot develop your character, if your character is not good, if your heart is not good, if all these rituals cannot transform this ego which is there in your heart to humility and appreciation for others, if it cannot change, you know, pride that you have in your heart for, you know, service attitude towards other, if it cannot bring any change in your heart to feel the pain of others, then what is the point of all this? On the contrary, whatever little you may do for God, but do it with knowledge and with your full heart and with the full consciousness to please the Lord. That is what is real devotion. That is what is the meaning of real devotion to God. The aim of all religious principles or all religious rituals, whatever given in the Vedas, they have been given, no doubt. All the different things have been given. But the aim of everything was what? Just to please God. And there is one shloka in Bhagavatam which explains that dharma sanashtita pumsa vishvaksena katasya na utpadayat yati ratim shrama evahi kevalam. This is a very, very significant verse, that if doing all those efforts, if the aim is that you don't please God, if you're not pleasing God, then what is the point? It is just shrama eva kevalam. Means it's just a waste of time. It's like a waste of energy. That's what we saw in the film, right? We saw that Krishna is not affected by all that. Krishna doesn't want anything. God doesn't want all those things. It's just a waste of energy. It's just a waste of time. So do we want to do something like that? Do something blindly with blind faith without understanding the meaning behind it? The first thing that attracted me to Krishna consciousness is like, because I was already rejecting religion, spirituality, God. I was rejecting mainly because I was not understanding why we are doing all this. I couldn't see myself in the future doing a Satyanarayan puja or, you know, I just couldn't, because I was thinking, why, what is the purpose behind it? If there is no understanding of why it is done, with what consciousness it is done, with what intention it is done, then I was not attracted to all that. So what attracted me to Krishna consciousness is, the first thing is that it is scientifically presented and it is scientifically explained. Everything is scientifically explained, that there is a meaning, there is a purpose, and the whole thing depends on your intention and your consciousness. With what consciousness do you doing? The same flower can be offered by a Brahmana in a very ritualistic, like a mechanic, you know, robot. You know, how like these robots, chavi deke, you know, you just leave them. Or you can do that same activity with so much love, with your whole consciousness, begging for the mercy of the Lord. That is the difference, you know. Difference like between a robot and a person who can think, feel, and love God, and genuinely do the rituals. And scientifically we can prove it. It's not that it is not scientific. We can prove it scientifically, that everything that is explained in the Vedas is, you know, now people ask, young people, or, you know, after seeing the, why temples? What is all this temple? So much big temples have been made. Why have been made? It's such a big waste. But if you go to see in the Vedas, and also scientifically it has been proved. Now medical, because I'm a doctor, there is something known as negative ions, which are necessary to combine the oxygen with the hemoglobin, you know, in the body. That negative ions are necessary, and it is also proved that places where there is no negative ions in the atmosphere, animals have died because of lack of negative ions. And the negative ions are reducing because of pollution and all. But the highest amount of these negative ions are present in the atmosphere in places such as on top of mountains, like hill stations, like at the seashores, or in a forest. So you see how scientifically the Vedic times, all the temples used to be on top of mountains, like Tirupati. They were at seashores. They were built like Rameshwaram and all the ancient temples. There is high content of negative ions, which will help to, you know, give oxygen to your blood. That's how scientifically it was designed. Even the inside, the Garbhagriha of the temple, like this is called the Garbhagriha, where the Lord is inside, that section is called the Garbhagriha. So that is known as the Sanctum Sanctorum. The Sanctum Sanctorum was so scientifically designed according to the height of the deity and the height of the ceiling, you know, so that the whole atmosphere within the Sanctum Sanctorum, the sound vibrations when people would chant the mantras, like when they chant Om, it's like a vibration. The whole air in the Garbhagriha would start vibrating. And the vibrations of Om are, you already know, you know, it's such a powerful vibration that it actually puts the whole body and the mind in equilibrium. Brings it in an equilibrium state. And that is very, very healthy for the body, mind and soul. That's how they were designed. It was scientifically designed. It was not just somebody just made some stone idol or a marble idol. That's what people say. In fact, there is a whole shastra which deals with construction or the carving of the deity, which is so scientifically designed. The height and, you know, how what size the deities will be. Everything is fixed in the Vedas. This is just few examples I'm giving. Like in every puja or rituals, you know, tulsi is given such an importance, right? A tulsi leaf is put in each article, whatever is offered. Anything that is offered, they'll say put a tulsi leaf. And today we know that tulsi has got so much anti-carcinogenic properties. In fact, it is said to keep off cancer every day if you eat some 5 or 6 leaves of tulsi. You can keep off cancer. You can protect yourself from cancer. This we know today, but they already knew the importance and the, and that's how they made that every ritual. In every Satyanarayan puja, they would put tulsi in each and every item that they are offering. But who would explain all that to us? Nobody explained. If we ask too many questions, they'll say, keep quiet. Don't waste our time. So this is just few examples how everything that can we see can be scientifically explained. More than anything, what satisfied me is that religion or spirituality is not something which is external, what we do external. It is more something to do with something which is internal. Is that even if you are doing aarti, if you do it with full devotion, full love, offering each item with love, that is an expression of your devotion. That itself makes that ritual, you know, pleasing to the Lord. And it doesn't remain this anymore. Then again questions are, there's such a big waste of food in temples. Why aren't temples, doing some charity? They are just taking this nariyals, hair and, you know, what all people offer in the temples, right? And it's like they feel God doesn't want your hair, God doesn't want so many nariyals. But the temples were not made for that. In fact, temples were considered like centers of knowledge. It was like an institution. It was like a university. It is meant for educating people, teaching people and making them understand the importance of serving God with love and devotion. And the way they were designed, they were like architectural, people are still studying the architectural beauty of all our ancient temples, right? So many temples in Hampi and all. They were designed scientifically, they were designed and they were centers of learning and knowledge. That was the main purpose of temples. And more than that, they were like centers of, for charity. All the people who could afford, they would donate, and the temples were like places where all the poor people could come and take food. That was the Indian culture before independence. Every temple would distribute food like that, distribute prasadam. In fact, my grandfather used to say that in Tirupati earlier, that laddus used to be just distributed like that. Now you have to stand in line, pay this money, then follow all these things and then you get. But olden times, they were just distributing. Because people had that, charitable nature. They would donate, give their, donation so that poor people could get. In fact, it was like a center where poor people could come and, get food free, any temple they could get. But today, everything you have lines. The Britishers, first thing they stopped after they, came, established their power in India, is stop free distribution of food. They just couldn't see that, how people can just distribute food freely. Till then there was no shortage in India. There was enough food for everyone. There is no shortage of food, there is shortage of, qualities in their heart, big-heartedness to distribute food. So temples were a medium where so much charity was done. So we are not against temples. We want people to understand what is the importance of a temple and how temples should be actually designed, what it is meant for. They should be like institutes where you can learn about service to God, just like how we are doing. You have all taken your valuable time to come and learn about spiritual matters and learning about God. Who talks about all these things today? Huh? Everybody talks about which disco to go, which film to see, right? At least you are coming here and learning about something which will bring you closer to God, right? So this is what is the real meaning of a temple. So it's not a question that you reject everything just because there is, something going wrong. You don't have to reject it as bad. It's just that we have to understand and educate people about the real purpose of it. That's all. We should not go to the extremes and say, no God, no temples and no this. Because that is going to take away that one chance that human beings have to become human. Because the world today is going towards total inhuman behavior. Animalistic, with no morality, no love, it's easy to become like that. What will save the world from becoming that is some hope of spirituality, bringing people closer to God. Otherwise there is so much darkness. Just today I was talking to my friend in US, they are billionaires. The billionaire, but the son died out of a drug overdose. Why was there so much darkness in his heart? Why was there so much pain that, you end your life in such a miserable way? What is the hope? The only hope is God. Only hope in this world is to bring people closer to God, which is the reservoir of all love. Because there is only one thing lacking in people's hearts today, and that is love. Due to lack of love, everything that you see in this world, the negative, bad things is happening only because of that. So why to become extreme and reject something which can actually give you, bring you closer to God, which can give you all these qualities? So one more thing in this film what we saw is that they brought out this concept of personal concept of God. Sometimes, by doing all these rituals, you actually start treating God as some impersonal thing. Impersonal means doesn't have any feelings, doesn't have any personality, doesn't have any, like very good point was brought out. That if somebody, you open your door and you see a big clump of hair in front of you, how will you feel? How will you feel? The question, how will you feel? That means you are thinking that God has feelings. That means God is a person, right? But what is happening today is that people are going away from understanding that God is also a person. He is also, a person who wants love, who wants your love, and who can feel, he also feels. This concept, somehow people don't understand. And they become so impersonal. So this point we would also like to bring out, which is brought out so nicely by Srila Prabhupada in Bhagavad, through his Bhagavad Gita. If you read it, you know, in every shloka you will see, you know, Bhagavad Krishna is showing that I am a person. If you do this, 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 I will be pleased. Patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam. If you offer me with love and devotion, I will be pleased. God is not like a robot. You know, sometimes you feel, why didn't God make us as robots? You know, everything would be so easy. But would you like somebody, you know, in your house who is programmed to love you, programmed to serve you? You set it only like that. The program is made only like that. That person will love you and will serve you. Will you be very satisfied with that? You want somebody who out of his free will, out of his own free will, wants to do something for you, right? Isn't that? That's the nature of human nature. We wouldn't want somebody who is made only like that. Same thing with God. He is also a person, so he has given us the free will. Okay, you can go to disco, you can chat on Facebook, you can do so many things, but I'd rather go to the temple and attend this program. So we have a choice in everything. That's because that comes only when you think that God is the person. God is not something impersonal, you know, who needs, you know, these candles or these chadars or these flowers as offerings or hair. He doesn't need all that. The only thing that he needs is that your love which you are offering through all those things, with all those items. And that is unconditional, you know, without any, you know, with your own free will you are offering it. So this is what we have to understand, the personal concept. You know, understanding God as our friend and as our Lord and Master. There's a very important shloka in Bhagavad Gita where Krishna tells that I will be known only by my bhakto sime sakha cheti. One who is my devotee means one who loves me and one who is my friend, sakha. So only if you consider God as a person will you develop these relationships, right? So basically spirituality is nothing but developing relationship with God. And all the things that you would do in this world to develop a relationship with anybody, all those principles are applicable here. So you can think how you can develop relationship with God. How do you make friends? Go on the Facebook profile, know everything about them. Okay, these are his hobbies, these are the things, right? You want to know something more about them, right? So that's the best way. When you know that God is a person, how you can develop your relationship about him? First, you should know what he is like, right? What he is like and what he likes and what he does not like. So this is how you develop a relationship. Start finding out more about God. Start finding, reading more about God. And there are lots and lots of scriptures. Thankfully, Prabhupada has given us thousands of literatures where we can read about Krishna. Learn what he is like as a person. What he likes. What I should do to please him. How I can become closer to him. Everything is given. But first we need to accept God as a person. And not just any person. A person who wants to know us, who wants to love us, and who is already showering all his love to us without even us reciprocating. That's how personal God is, you know. But the sorry thing today is like the hypocrisy that we see in religion. That kind of puts off so many people, right? There's hypocrisy in every, there is hypocrisy and cheating in every field if you go to see. Even in the medical field. In Satyamev Jayate, there was one whole special episode on how medical field is such a, you know, how people are cheating and they are doing this and that. So many things were discussed in that. But do we just decide, okay, medical field is a very cheating thing, so we'll banish all doctors, banish the whole medical field, we don't need them at all. Is that practical? There is hypocrisy everywhere, in every field. Why to take the bad examples? Why not take the good things? There are hypocrisy even in religious, in spiritual world. You know, jaise bolte na, all five fingers are not same. Right? But why should we reject something totally? Is it practical? Medicine is important for the body, right? Similarly, spiritual knowledge is also important for developing our inner qualities. The inner humane qualities, the inner spiritual qualities are necessary. And how will you learn that? The only way we can learn is by approaching bona fide and true spiritual leaders or spiritual masters who will guide us in the right way. Right? There is hypocrisy in every situation, but the only thing we can do in our life is pray to God. That if I am sincere in my heart, if I am sincerely looking for you, if I am sincerely thinking that I want to become closer to you, then guide me to the right kind of people, right kind of person, or the right kind of place where I can learn about God in a right way without any exploitation or any aim for getting something out of me, and with the only aim of learning how to please you in a scientific way, with true understanding and understanding the value of our consciousness, and how if we just purify our consciousness by following some spiritual cultures, some spiritual rituals, I may call it ritual, but rituals are like formulas. If it is offered in a, with our whole consciousness, it can become spiritual. Like ritual can become a spiritual experience. The same rituals can be turned into spiritual. Why spiritual? The added thing is our consciousness. Our love is added onto it. So we have to pray in a genuine way that to give us the path, to show us the path, in the right path where we can come more closer to God. So I would beg all of you that we have tried to explain everything, all the different aspects, and we'll have a good question answer session also. But the main aim of calling this as Oh My God is to make you understand the importance of God in your life. God is just a post, just like Prime Minister, President is a post. God is just a post, and a post is usually impersonal, right? But the person who holds that post of God is a person who has a name, who has a personality, who has a feeling, right? And we call him Krishna. And Christians call him Jehovah. And Muslims call him Allah. There are different names of the same personality. But it is God himself in different names. And each name has a meaning. So I would beg all of you, let us all close our eyes. And instead of, Oh my God, we call out, Oh my Krishna. Oh my Krishna. Thank you very much. So we should have some questions. If there is any question, or if we have not understood something, then we can try to answer? I would like to invite all of you. The next Chetana is, of course, I will be announcing the dates, but we are also organizing a youth festival in Bhaktivedanta Hospital where I am working on 19th of January. And the theme of that event is What's Life? So I would like to invite all of you, whoever is interested, to participate on 19th January, 5 o'clock onwards in the auditorium on the 5th floor. And the theme is What's Life? And if anybody has any talent on this theme, would like to present a skit or a dance or a whatever, mono acting, you can contact me and we can include you in the youth festival. Thank you.
Okay. You just told that as a spiritual person, they don't run after name. That is true for a spiritual person, but as a doctor, wouldn't you like to have a name for yourself or to work more for your name and to develop a position as a doctor in a society? Or you would rather prefer being a spiritual person who is unknown to your patients or the surroundings?
I would rather prefer to be the best doctor and be known to many people, but with the sole aim of serving them and also connecting them to the real source, that is the Lord. And I would work more hard to increase my name and increase my reach to as many patients as possible, but not for name, not for fame.
For serving.
But for serving more people. A real spiritualist, his only aim in life will be how I can serve others in the name of God. And when any persons, if we are benefiting, like any people by our service, if anybody is benefiting, then we should confidently tell them that it was not me who has cured you. Because that is a fact. Are we curing anybody?
No.
No doctor can claim that he is curing.
But if it is taking more of your time rather than your sitting and chanting and rather going and serving the patient, it becomes a bit of contradictory, this thing coming to, rather than you are spending time with the patient or you are sitting and chanting.
There is no contradiction, because the spiritual practices that we are doing is for our own self, which we do in a time when it is going to benefit us as spirit souls connected to God. And why are we doing it? So that we get the right consciousness and the strength to serve as many people as possible in the right consciousness. So there is no actually contradiction. It is just that we think that in the name of spirituality, I am going to neglect my work. But that is not true. A true doctor who is a spiritual by nature will understand that all the spiritual practices which I am doing is for strengthening my spirituality or my commitment to God, so that I can give the same love what I am receiving through those spiritual practices from God, I can give as many people as possible. So there is no contradiction actually. You can actually do this work of as a doctor in the consciousness that actually I am serving God only. So both become spiritual. It's not something separating. You can't separate your work from spirituality. You understood that point? Thank you.
Last question.
Yeah, I got a question. You said that you got to love God and that's what you offer God when you pray. So my question is that we are so much caught up with our daily lives and we are influenced by it's our guilt praying the God, if we are scared of something, of a situation, it's that thing that's praying God. So how do we get love in all this?
Basically asking, how do we get out of this kind of a
cycle
that we are in, that when we are fearful, when we are guilty, we approach God,
like
right?
If there's some exam coming up, I'll pray, RAR, pass karwa do, type. So How do you get out of this and you
it's
actually
a vicious
pray
cycle,
for...
you know. You get into this kind of a cycle of thinking that God is waiting there, standing there just like an order supplier, you know. Okay, aaj ka order kya hai? Like kind of people is, God is waiting there just to take your orders. Aaj exam pass kara do, homework not done, usko, you know. It's like you think that God is just an order supplier. First, you have to understand and learn that God is not an order supplier. He is a person who actually thinks and feels. So you need to change your attitude towards God basically. First thing is change your attitude. That now I want to know more about you and how should I develop my relationship with you. Now you are getting a little more deeper. Order supplier, he is one of the work God does is order supplying. But you have to go one step closer to God now. You have been given that opportunity today. You have been given that opportunity by God Himself that yes, come to my temple, learn about me and get attracted to me and, you know, form a relationship. So that you, then you can, only then you can get out of this vicious cycle. That is the only way. Otherwise there is no other way. Otherwise everybody is caught up in this vicious cycle.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Any other question?
Yeah. Hare Krishna. Mataji, my brother always says that I know you will talk about Krishna. Krishna is a God also. But he has a one big question that in every scriptures, in every means, if there is a Hanuman Chalisa or... whatever the books we have of every demigods, he says that everywhere it is written that you must follow this, you must follow that. So give me that a strong difference, like why should I follow Krishna only? And this is question asked by many of my friends, but before being a true conscious, having a consciousness to Krishna, I was not able to answer these questions. So Mataji, can you please?
Basically you're asking that every demigod prayers has something that
it,
you have to follow.
Yeah,
actually
every,
that is given in the Vedas.
Everywhere,
you know, that
it is written.
Every Veda, in the Vedas, every, you know, like Hanuman Chalisa or many other mantras like this have been given that this, that if you chant this mantra, you'll get benefit or you can, you know, develop you know, faith and devotion to that devata. So we should not actually, we are not against, we should not discourage anyone who is having some sincere faith or sincere, you know, love for some certain level. We are not against all that. We are not there to make people think that only Krishna. It's nothing like that. So we should, if there is somebody who is particular God who's doing, we should just encourage them that yes, you can continue doing that, but you can also worship this, because the Shastras are saying that by worshipping Krishna, he is like the root of the tree. When you water the root, all the trees, plants and, you know, flowers, shrubs, everybody is satisfied, right? So there is a shloka in the Bhagavatam which actually quotes and says that all the demigods and all the different devatas who have been empowered by God, by Lord Krishna, they are like the different parts of the tree. And the root is Lord Krishna. So if you water the root, automatically every part will be satisfied. And that too we can only explain or tell them. There is no hard and fast rule. This is not something mechanized, you know. The problem with religion today, people are rejecting religion mainly because it's becoming so fanatical. Why should everyone, you know, why should you force your ideas on others? If you feel something about something, you do it as so nicely and you be such a good example in that, or show that how it has helped you so much that people will automatically feel that what is so good about this, you know, why are you looking so happy and so blissful? Why you always look so blissful? You don't have to chant all these mantras like how we are chanting, or you don't have to go walking to this temple without chappals, and you know, they do so many rituals. So that is real spirituality, where you have to rise above all these things. Otherwise we will be also like fanatical religion, like a fanatical religion, forcing people to do what I am doing, you know. That is not what is the purpose of religion. Real spirituality is you have to rise above all that and make everyone feel that you can love God. Anyone can love God. And we only want to speak about that. Real devotion to the Lord. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your time. I'm really very happy to be with all of you, and a very, very happy new year to all of you again. And now we'll go to the most important part, and I want all of you, personally I'll talk to you, okay? The most important part of the program now is like, we are going to sing and dance together in glorification to the Lord. So we should not do it as a ritual, we should do it as a spiritual activity. So with all the love in your heart, with all the emotion, spiritual emotion that we can muster in our little hearts, we should offer it to Gopinath ji today. So please participate in the kirtan with all your heart and sing loudly and dance enthusiastically. Thank you very much.